What would happen if modern engineers had to build like our ancient ancestors?
Oh, we lost part of the Conquerors.
The ancient Egyptians built the Great Pyramid in 20 years. They cut tombs in the Valley of the Kings using hammers and chisels. They raised these vast columns and this obelisk, all 300 tons of it, with nothing more than manpower. Did you ever wonder how? We did.
So we decided to build one the way we think that they did it. Everybody go back on that side.
Our team will walk in the footsteps of the ancient world's best engineers.
Can you get on a rope?
They're planning.
The Egyptians left nothing to chance.
Their organization.
1, 2, 3, pull wouldn't do it.
Their execution.
Insert a wedge, and that section of rock, it will come away really easily.
Their sheer ambition.
You've got 1,500 years of history here, of construction, of destruction, and also of reconstruction.
45 centuries after the first pyramid rose from the desert, they're going to reimagine, recreate, and finally understand the way the Egyptians engineered the impossible. At dig sites, in museums, at their desks. For over 200 years, scholars have grappled with the mysteries of ancient Egypt, trying to explain how its great monuments came into being. These are tough puzzles, and now it's someone else's turn. Across three continents, we've put together a team of people who solve engineering challenges every day. Their task is to think, work, and build like Egyptians. Steve Burrows is one of the world's top structural engineers. He's used to building big. He builds stadiums and skyscrapers and airports. He's never been to Egypt before, but he's going to examine each structure and piece together the story of how his counterparts in the ancient world did their job.
Wow.
Incredible.
This is a very recognizable building shape.
The task for architectural designer Charlie Luxton is to look at the big picture, decode these buildings from their plans and blueprints. While 8,000 kilometers away at the University of Lafayette, Louisiana, Dr. Chris Carroll has set up a field lab.
You know, I can't imagine being in the desert, 30 degrees hotter, in sandals doing this.
A civil engineer and construction expert with a whole class of would-be pyramid builders at his command, he's going to try and put it all into practice.
There's a little bit worse.
The pyramids. The obelisk. The Great Hall at Karnak. The Valley of the Kings, and the great lost wonder, the Pharos. We're going to find out how Egypt was built. There's something about building tall. People have been doing it since the dawn of history. And for 4,500 years, the undisputed world champions of building tall were the ancient Egyptians. It all begins with one structure. It is the prototype for every Egyptian pyramid. But it's more than that. It is the oldest cut stone building anywhere on Earth. It is the oldest multi-story structure. It's called the Step Pyramid.
This is a very recognizable building type. And actually, it's found all over the world. South America, Central America, Egypt, Asia, Southeast Asia. Now, it could be that they're all built by space aliens. But no, it's because it's a very obvious way of building big and building tall. And pretty much all societies, civilizations, once they reach a certain point, want to build tall. And this is the earliest surviving built expression of that desire.
Because it sits alone in the desert, it's hard to gauge just how big the Step Pyramid is. But if you picked it up and dropped it in a 21st century city, it'd take up most of a block. And it's as tall as a 20-story high-rise.
Just the scale of the building. Not just the entire building itself, but every piece of it. Every stone is large. There's no way that one man can pick up one of those stones. That it was teamwork. There must have been thousands of people working on this.
We know that this building evolved from what had been a traditional Egyptian tomb, a single-story building with a body buried beneath it. To gain height, the builders added smaller and smaller versions of the same design, one on top of another.
It's just a pile of stones, but it's enormous. And I wonder whether it was like some large experiment in the idea of building tall.
But there's more to this building than meets the eye. To architectural designer Charlie Luxton, the plans tell a remarkable story.
At first glance, you'd be forgiven for thinking that this is a very simple, almost crude building. It's just a pile of stones. But in fact, it is anything but. This is an incredibly complex building.
And buried beneath the Step Pyramid, there are miles of tunnels. Egypt's chief archaeologist, Dr. Zahi Hawass, explains that they had a religious purpose.
It's about 3 miles of tunnels and corridors.
Wow.
That was the vision of the ancient Egyptian, how they imagined the afterlife. The netherworld, Osiris is sitting in the burial chamber waiting for the king to go through all these dark tunnels and corridors.
Well, what an achievement to dig 3 miles of tunnels. And this rock is really soft as well.
Yeah.
So quite dangerous.
The idea that you build a pyramid by putting one layer of stone, putting a smaller one on top and a smaller one on top of that, it seems relatively simple. You know, we could teach a 4-year-old child to build a pyramid out of building blocks, then ask that child to put a tunnel underneath that pyramid, and the complexity is huge. And I start to wonder, how did they explain that to the workforce?
After 20 minutes of walking and crawling through the cramped tunnels, they find themselves in the space directly beneath the center of the pyramid.
Oh, fantastic.
It's amazing.
This is just a huge chamber.
The ancient Egyptian is told.
It's disorientating. The ceiling way above them is in fact only at ground level. It's the base of the pyramid. Above that is another 60 meters of rock.
What we've got here is a sort of iceberg of a building. That is to say that you can see a small amount of the Step Pyramid above ground, but below ground, there's just this huge amount of construction that's taking place.
This, then, is the true genius of pyramid design. We may produce taller buildings. There may be buildings which cover more ground. But given their 4,000-year head start, it's hard to imagine mankind ever building anything else which lasts as long as the pyramids. Meet the team from Lafayette University, Louisiana. These guys are the engineers of the future. And none of them has ever seen a pyramid collapse. No one has,
Sure, some have been systematically plundered, pulled down, and carted off stone by stone. But these are the most enduring structures on Earth. What makes them that way? They're going to do a little experiment. They're laying the foundation for a giant concrete box. When it's ready and filled with sand, they're hoping it'll pass for the shifting deserts of Egypt. Now, Chris Carroll teaches his students how to engineer buildings in all manner of shapes and styles. But no one round here has ever built anything like this. This is the Great Pyramid of Lafayette, the first Cajun pyramid.
All right, so we were curious to see what a pyramid would do with an instability, so we decided to build one. Now, this is a little bit different in scale than what you would see in Egypt. If you saw an Egyptian pyramid on this scale, it would probably be about 2 feet tall, but we decided to build it a little bit taller just so we could magnify the effect of that instability. Now, the one thing that makes the pyramid the most stable shape is the fact that the center of gravity is low with respect to where its base is. Basically, in this, the center of gravity is approximately about right here, so about one-third from the base.
One side is a wooden panel, hinged like the tailgate of a truck. For an Egyptian pyramid to suddenly collapse, the earth would have to move beneath it. Here, Chris's student Craig Girard is going to use his truck to provide a landslide.
You're going backwards first, and I'm going to hit you. Okay. All right, Craig, hold right there. Hold right there. Okay, we're good. The pins are loose. All right, Toby, can you pull the pin? Reed, pull this one. Okay, go ahead and get back. Okay, so it's starting to shift just a few degrees.
It's already leaning further than most modern buildings could take.
Shift it a little bit more. All right, so it's starting to shift just a little bit more, so you're looking at about 15, 20 degrees right there.
The pyramid's leaning more than 30 degrees now, and it's still standing.
Okay, it's continuing to go. Looks like it's about to topple. So there it goes, a little bit more. And there it goes. So the full failure of the whole thing. And that is a little surprising. I was not expecting it to last that long at all. All right, good job, Rick. Foundation started to go on one side of it, and the pyramid started to shift. As it started to shift, you start increasing the pressure on the front, which causes it to shift more, and then the sand starts moving a little bit more, the pyramid shifts a little bit more, and it just keeps going. It's kind of like a chain reaction. So once it starts going, it's kind of hard to stop it. So you can see that with a instability in the foundation, the structure is just not going to stand. And if we had built a model with a perfectly square block, the center of gravity would have been higher, and that process would have went much, much quicker. You know, even though this one has collapsed, this is why pyramids have withstood for thousands of years, is because they keep a uniform pressure on their foundations by being perfectly plumb or perfectly vertical.
And that's why the Step Pyramid, the oldest cut stone monument that we have, still stands. It marks a major turning point, not just for Egyptian engineering, but for the world. But still, this wasn't the oldest surviving structure in Egypt. Not by a long way. These ruins lie in the heart of Egypt. Crumbled walls reach up out of the desert. And though in the land of pyramids, temples, and carved tombs, they may not at first glance seem like much, they are an engineering miracle all their own. This is a link back to the earliest times of the Egyptian Empire. It's called Hierakonpolis.
Hierakonpolis was known as the City of the Hawk. It was an extremely important city around about 3500 BC. We think as many as 10,000 people lived there, so it was really a thriving metropolis.
Yes, there are bigger monuments in Egypt, but two facts taken together make this one extraordinary. Firstly, it's made not out of stone, but mud brick, baked in the sun. Second, it was constructed around 3500 BC. That makes it one of the oldest buildings on Earth. When the Great Pyramid was built, the fort at Hierakonpolis had already stood for over 1,000 years. So the question for Steve is, why is it still standing?
So Richard, tell me a bit about the site, the geology of the area, and what are the foundation materials upon which the building actually sits?
Pretty much desert as you see it now. They built right on the desert plateau. The structure is built over an earlier cemetery where there were graves dug and filled in sand.
With this information, the mystery deepens. Without a stable, even base, anyone trying to create a permanent building is asking for trouble. It's why today's engineers sink foundations. 21st century AD, or 35th century BC, the rules don't change.
And the ground always settles under a building. I mean, you can't avoid settlements. Number one most important thing for a structure is to understand the ground conditions and to be confident that they're as consistent as possible. So they knew that there were different foundation materials underneath the building, and yet they still built it on this particular site.
That's right. They just made good as they went.
Number two most important environmental factor is to consider the way that nature is going to interact with the building. So, for example, the sun rises in the morning and moves around the building. And materials, when they're heated up, they expand. And the building is moving due to temperature variations during the day. And you need to be aware of that. And then finally, loads are applied, forces are applied to the building just naturally through wind and driving rain and sandstorms. And they're all trying to basically erode the building and, you know, take it back to dust. So buildings are always responding to the environment that they're in and everything that surrounds them, and engineers have to design for those conditions.
In the story of Hierakonpolis, climate plays a major part. Like all the important sites of ancient Egypt, this city takes life from the Nile. It grew in the thin strip of land which runs along the riverbanks and is made fertile by its annual flood. But then things changed.
During the time where Hierakonpolis was thriving, the ancient Nile was actually much closer. Today, when we look at the structure, it is in the middle of the desert.
The city died. There's nothing here to sustain any size of population. And as the desert swept through it and over it, what had been a hospitable environment became brutal. Daytime temperatures here peak at 46 degrees Celsius. At night, they drop to 6 degrees. Rain is rare, but when it comes in torrents, bringing flash floods. Worst of all is the wind. It regularly passes in from the Sahara at over 130 kilometers an hour, blasting the walls with sand. And yet, long after the men who built them have gone, the mud brick walls are still here. The city's engineers chose mud brick for the same reason that people throughout Egypt did, and do. It's cheap, and it's very easy to get hold of.
What we get from ancient Hierakonpolis is a tiny glimpse into what ancient Egypt looked like. Mud brick is something that was available to the ancient Egyptians from the very earliest times. When they came to the Nile Valley, all they had to do was to take the mud from the riverbank, press it into moles, and dry it, and then lay it down in courses along with mortar. So, I mean, it's a relatively easy method of construction, and they're using materials that are literally in their backyard.
Given its ready availability, it's easy to understand why the ancient Egyptians built with mud. But it's not the toughest of materials. It's much less durable than, say, stone. The more you look at it, the more remarkable it seems that this building has survived so long, particularly when you consider one final surprising factor. Hierakonpolis sits in the middle of an earthquake zone. So somewhere in the construction of this fort is the secret of its long life. An ability to withstand forces that might tear down more modern buildings. Melinda's going to look at the bricks themselves, the way they were produced. This isn't the most glamorous of assignments for archaeologists, but it might be the best way to solve an enduring puzzle. What is the secret ingredient?
One thing I can really pick up with this is there's a tremendous amount of stickiness to it.
Absolutely, that's the clay. So the clay will bind all, you know, the sand and the silt together. Clay is key, really. Then you'll have your top straw, basically, and that enables, it gives strength to the brick. It also enables it to dry faster without making it heavier, like sand.
And so tell me what the manure does.
And the manure, well, it's the same thing, basically, but it also makes the brick water resistant. So people use blood, urine.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the Egyptians prefer manure today. So that's kind of what we're putting in our bricks.
But it, is that also protective? I mean,
yeah,
the next thing I was going to ask you, that when it comes to the weathering of mud brick, it's manure that is the...
It's actually, one of the key things.
In Egypt today, mud brick is still one of the favorite building materials.
There you go.
That's beautiful.
Got yourself a brick.
Okay, all right.
This particular recipe, honed by generations, might explain how the bricks can endure extreme weather. But how did these walls withstand the power unleashed by nature's most destructive force? Earthquakes. Steve discovered a section of the wall where a partial collapse has revealed the internal structure. And this is where he finds his answer.
What we can see here is how the construction was actually laid down, how the bricks are bonded. As you get into the depth of the building, what we're starting to see is that the joints between the bricks are pretty random. I mean, the construction is far from perfect. There's 4 million bricks in this building, so there's something like 16 million joints. So what we have are like 16 million small energy absorbers that weren't designed but just naturally occurred through the fact that these are, you know, relatively unskilled people putting together mud bricks in a far from perfect manner. The mistakes in the construction have enabled it to survive some of the events that it's experienced.
Today's engineers take great pains to make quake-resistant structures. They conduct tests in vast multi-million dollar facilities, and their findings are used to prevent disaster and save lives.
From our current knowledge of seismic engineering, we can look back at the building and see the reasons why it still exists today.
Of course, the Egyptians didn't think in this way. They had no such knowledge, no such equipment. But they do seem to have had the overwhelming desire to leave a permanent mark. And they did do experiments of their own. The desert became one giant laboratory, and they made some giant mistakes. When it came to construction, the Egyptians moved fast. From their first attempts to make big stone buildings to the completion of the Great Pyramid, less than 200 years. The drive was to build bigger, taller, better. Every building broke new ground as ambition bred innovation. The Step Pyramid was still brand new when plans were made to attempt something almost 150 meters tall. Twice the height.
If you can make one pyramid twice as high as the next, it takes eight times the volume of rock, and it's four times the engineering complexity. They were making big step changes in technology when they went from one size to the next.
The building that resulted from those plans is known as the Bent Pyramid. No other pyramid looks like this one.
Looking at the Bent Pyramid, the first reaction has got to be, why? I mean, why did they change the angle? Why is it bent at the top? Is it some massive mistake, or was it designed like this?
About halfway up, the steep angle of its sides changes. They come together abruptly, as if a much taller pyramid has been folded in on itself. The sides still bear much of the smooth limestone which originally clad the entire building.
Luckily, we've still got the casing stones on this pyramid. I think we should measure the angle at a few places, really, just to try and assess the quality.
So I'm going to start over here. It's about as far as we can reach from here. We get readings of 53.5 degrees.
Okay.
And if we pick the next one along, 54 degrees, so, you know, half a degree difference. Let's have a look, check for consistency in a few places. 53.5. 53.5. 54 degrees. I mean, 1 degree difference on what we took 6 or 7 measurements.
It's unbelievable, isn't it? Absolutely unbelievable.
What Steve's first examination immediately reveals is just how quickly the pyramid builders have learned.
What we're seeing on the Bent Pyramid is that the quality of everything is improving. The quality of stone that's coming from the quarry is better. The cutting of it is better. The material delivered to site is in much better shape. They've understood better how to build these things, how to lift the stones, and how to tighten the joints.
If they had continued at their original angle, they'd have produced an immense building, taller than anything that would be seen on Earth for around the next 4,000 years. But the builders clearly had a change of heart. Did they find it simply too difficult to build something this steep? Perhaps the answer lies inside.
Here's the way in.
This is the workers' entrance to the pyramid, 12 meters above the ground. As soon as Steve and Melinda enter, they spot a crack.
Oh wow, look. Almost as soon as we go in.
I mean, there's this huge gap between stones.
Yeah, now that doesn't look natural, does it?
Uh-uh,
I mean, it looks like there's been some movement up there.
Just how deep do these cracks go? They move down the access tunnel, further into the pyramid.
A little bit higher here. Oh, wow. Look at this. Here we've got a big, big crack.
Look at that.
Yeah, figure out what's going on here. So, we can see that these plates here, see these pieces of rock?
Mm-hmm.
Only about an inch wide,
They've just sheared off. So there's been a lot of movement taking place here.
And it's much larger than it is.
It is.
Much at the beginning, than, yeah.
And I'm guessing as we go further down, we're
going to get larger.
Yeah, I think so. But let's go down the tunnel and have a look.
The Egyptians were building to honor the kings that they worshipped as gods. They wanted their work to last forever and be perfect. So the cracks are a problem on two counts.
Okay. Staircase here. Wow. We've got to be right in the middle of the pyramid now. Okay, big space up here.
That's a relief. It's amazing.
Just as with the step pyramid, the interior of the bent pyramid opens out into a huge central chamber.
Okay, look at it. Come on, have a look at this.
That's not good.
This is a sheer crack. So what we've got here is that this section of rock is stable and this one is moving. This section's moving down into that staircase area we've just come up. This is really recent. It shows there's still movement taking place in the pyramid. You can tell by the sharp edges here.
Yeah.
They erode with time and get much smoother on the edges. So this one is very fresh.
So how fresh? How fresh is this crack?
Very recent. Maybe a day, maybe a few months, but not much longer than that. So there's still movement taking place in the pyramid, even today. It's quite a scary thought, isn't it?
Yeah.
Built on sand foundations, the bent pyramid is moving.
Looks like it's about to topple. So there it goes, a little bit more. And there it goes.
Chris Carroll's pyramid in Lafayette collapsed as the ground beneath it slipped. The same thing's happening here. It's just over millennia rather than seconds.
So the first cracks probably didn't worry anybody. You know, they just expected them. They had cracks all the time. Some of the stones, they settled and they moved around and they absorbed the load as the load was piled on top. But of course, normally those cracks, after they happen, the movement becomes less and less over time. I think what they saw with the bent pyramid is that the movement got worse. Probably a big meeting took place and a complete redesign. And they said, well, you know, they understood why the problems were occurring. Let's try and find a way to solve them.
The sudden change in angle is the answer. Reduce its height, reduce the volume. Reduce the weight of stone bearing down and threatening disaster. Only compromise kept and keeps the structure standing.
Even the razor in between.
This imperfect pyramid was discarded, abandoned, never used by the pharaoh for whom it was intended. But the millions of tons of rock and the millions of man-hours that went into it were not wasted.
You might think that building a pyramid today, the most important thing that we would have would be the technology, the heavy lifting equipment, the moving equipment, the stone cutting equipment, but it's not. It's the knowledge. It's the complex maths and physics that would allow us to understand exactly how this building was going to behave before we built it. Because the Egyptians just didn't have that. They've been building pyramids for about a generation, and they were just making it up as they went along. So this building, more than almost any other, is a prototype. It's an enormous experiment.
The Step Pyramid, and then the Bent Pyramid, were extraordinary monuments in their own right. Groundbreaking. Revolutionary. But history remembers them as part of something even bigger, even grander. They are prototypes, developments on the way to the creation of the most recognizable, most talked about building ever constructed. It is the Great Pyramid. And for all the talk, it still stuns visitors.
Wow. You tend to think of the Great Pyramid as a solid mass, and you realize that inside there's just an incredible amount of space. It's a three-dimensional stone maze. These passageways, they go up at an inclination and they turn through angles. It would have looked like an incredibly complex puzzle to the people who were building it, and must have been recorded in drawings both on plan and in section.
756 foot along each side of its base, rising to a height of 481 foot. Built of about 2.3 million different blocks of stone, each weighing an average of 2.5 tons. That's more than 6 million tons of rock. Built over a 20-year period, which means that a block of stone had to be going into place every 5 minutes throughout day and night of that entire period. And then it was capped with an alloy of gold and silver. I mean, not only is this the most audacious, incredible piece of architecture, it is a miracle of logistics.
And yet numbers alone can hardly convey the scale of what was achieved here. The first challenge for anyone wanting to understand this building is to understand its extraordinary place in history.
If you look, the last pyramid that we can see there, that is the pinnacle of pyramid engineering. It is the last standing monument of the seven wonders of the world. And today, it is 481 feet high.
So at that sort of height, it was the tallest building in the world for quite some time?
If you can believe it, it was the tallest building for 3,800 years.
The big question for me is, how did they actually build these things?
It's about stone. Cutting it, shaping it, shifting it, and lifting it. Since stone is one of the few resources that is plentiful on the Giza Plateau, most of it was quarried locally. Nevertheless, how does a civilization with so little technology go about producing that many perfect blocks?
How did they make them? What kind of tools did they need? How long did it take to craft them?
Melinda is with Dennis Stocks. He has spent years trying to understand exactly how the ancient Egyptians worked.
This is the way they used to prepare the blocks. They could split them along the size that they wanted, simply by using hard wooden wedges.
It's not about using brute force. It's the skill of the mason in understanding and exploiting the stone's weakness.
Amazing. It takes really relatively little man work to be able to reduce the block in size.
That's right.
And you could be doing a lot of them at the same time.
It takes experience to turn these rough shapes into precisely cut blocks. The pyramid design demands absolute uniformity, and the stone cutter can only rely on his eye and a simple set square. The blocks are all shaped in the quarry, so that the men that are moving them are not handling unnecessary weight. They use sledges and slipways to bring the stones to the pyramid site, but before a single block can be laid, the ground has to be prepared.
If we're 1 degree out on the ground, when we amplify that through 400 feet, we're going to have a pyramid that's leaning over to one side. So the most important thing that we can do right from the beginning is make that ground absolutely flat.
Yeah, I've just measured how horizontal the surface is on this layer of stone here. Every single measurement within half a degree of being horizontal. I mean, it's just geometric perfection.
How could they have achieved this over such a wide area? Steve believes that the only answer is to make use of a substance which always finds its own level. Water.
If you actually marked out the edges of this large square
with just one layer of mud brick, and you flooded it with water, and you cut down every piece of rock that was above the water, and then you removed it, and you repeated the exercise. The water would obviously be evaporating and continuously lowering itself, and you just carried on cutting the stone down and cutting it down. Eventually, I'm going to create a perfectly level base.
So, with the foundations laid, construction can now begin.
Imagine this, the first block of stone arrives on site. Where'd you put it? I think you put one block at each of the four corners. And positioning those is quite difficult too. What if it was slightly twisted out, such that if you laid the next block next to it, you started going off, even at a few degrees? By the time you get 750 feet, you're not going to meet the other corner. Not very many men are required on site at that time, but they have to be working incredibly accurately. Let's assume we've now just got four blocks in place, and the next blocks arrive on site. Where do you put those? I think you put them halfway along each length. And the reason you do that is, for the first time, you can actually start sighting a level line around all the sides of the pyramid.
It's only when all this is done, the site leveled, and the key first layer set in place, that the builders could meet the biggest challenge of all. There were over 2 million blocks still to come. How did they lift them?
There are many different theories as to how the Great Pyramid was actually built, but nearly all of them involve some kind of ramp. And it is really the simplest way of lifting materials. You have a right angle triangle, and you just drag stuff up the longest side. Simple. But on this scale, it's anything but.
In Louisiana, Chris Carroll and his team have decided to build their own ramp. They're about to play tug of war with a 2-ton piece of concrete.
Of all the theories of how the Great Pyramid was built, the one that is best known and so beloved by Hollywood is the single ramp theory. And it's incredibly simple. It's just a great big ramp made of mud brick or sand, with an army of people dragging the stones up it. And as the pyramid gets bigger, the ramp gets bigger as well.
It's been argued that any construction ramp would have an ideal incline of between 7 and 9 degrees. Any steeper, and stone hauling becomes unmanageable, even with a large team. But as the ramp gets bigger, the need to preserve this angle is going to cause problems.
Because the gradient of the ramp is so slight, you'd have had to build a huge length of material on the new ramp, another 3 feet higher, before you could bring one single stone onto the site.
And yet the numbers say that if construction took 20 years, a block had to be laid once every 3 minutes in a 12-hour day. If the workforce kept having to stop and wait, they'd have to move even faster. And 11,000 kilometers away, in Louisiana, Chris has identified another problem.
Now, when we're building the ramp, we had to slope the sides, because if we didn't, the ramp would be unstable. This is similar to what the Egyptians would have done, with just to have stability in the ramp, so you really couldn't have a sheer face on each side of the ramp. And basically, what you're having to do is you're having to build a whole other pyramid, even with the Egyptians using mud bricks. You have to build another pyramid just to get up to the actual pyramid.
Take this problem and amplify it with a pyramid that's going to reach 140 feet in the air. And the single ramp theory just seems totally flawed.
So here's the Great Pyramid, over 400 feet high, and a ramp at 7 degrees would have stretched a mile out into the desert in this direction. It couldn't have vertical sides because it's impossible, so the side would have had to be ramped, making the ramp, the volume of the ramp, bigger than the volume of the pyramid itself. So I don't believe the theory of a single ramp. I just think it's impossible that a ramp of that scale could have been used to construct this pyramid.
But some sort of ramp still seems the most likely answer. What if it had a different shape?
The next theory is the external spiral ramp. And this is an idea where you take that incredibly long ramp necessary to reach the top of the pyramid, and then you wrap it around itself as it's going up. And it has two real advantages. The first is that the pyramid provides a large part of the bulk necessary for the ramp. And the second is that the additional load from the ramp is evenly spread on the building, and it won't push it over.
Picture this, you need a surface, horizontally flat surface, upon which you're going to push the stones up this ramp. And on the outside, you have a wall that has to be inclined outwards for stability. And it's full of earth, and it's built on the side of a pyramid that's also built at quite a steep angle. So if you actually draw those things and you project the line down, it would probably have to go right to the ground, all the way around the pyramid. So effectively, you would be building a complete mud brick wrapper to the entire building as you built upwards. I just think that's completely implausible and impractical.
The Egyptians used hemp rope, hand woven. Given that they'd need hundreds of kilometers of it on the pyramid's construction site, rope making alone was a major industry. And the rope needed men on it.
So we're getting ready to try to pull the block up the ramp, and we're going to start off by using two guys. Let's start pulling, see if you can get it to move.
As the boys pull, it's worth remembering that the average ancient Egyptian stood just a few inches over 5 feet tall.
All right, maybe we need one more person. Toby, yeah. Come here, jump in here. Jump in here. All right, come on, guys. Let's try this. Let's get one more. Kalen, come on, let's try. Let's get one more. Let's see if we can do the four.
Hustle, baby. Hustle up there.
All right, guys, you ready? Let's go. Hold up. All right, Joseph, come on. Let's just try five. Yeah,
all right, come on now. This is one block. Once. If these guys had been in Egypt 4,500 years ago, they'd be doing this all day. Every day. For years. In bare feet and under a desert sun.
Hold it, guys. Hold it. Let it back easy. Let it back easy. All right, guys. Let's try it with all eight people. Let's see what we're going to do. All right. Harrison, Craig, and Hayden. Let's go ahead and try it with all eight and see what happens. All right, guys.
Yeah, we
got to
go slow.
All right, no. You're doing the same thing you did last time.
Okay.
All right.
Clearly, our boys are novices at ramp building and stone hauling. But some of the ideas about how the pyramids were built seem almost to assume that the ancient Egyptians had superpowers.
The latest theory is the internal spiral ramp theory, and it's probably the most incredible. The idea is that as they were building the pyramid, they put a spiraling internal ramp within the volume of the building, and you pop the 2.5-ton stones out at the top to build the building up. And then when you're finished, you fill it back in. And then if you look within the structure of the pyramid, you will still find traces of that spiral tunnel. Well, that's the theory.
That ramp would need to have a finite width. It had to be big enough for, you know, large numbers of men to pull large blocks of stone all the way up the building. But of course, the pyramid gets smaller as it goes up. So practically, it could never get to the top because you would run out of space. Also, that method would have meant there could have only been one ramp. So the whole train would have been very slow, very laborious, and only delivering one stone to the workplace at a time.
All right, so we've tried five guys, we can't get it going, so we're going to try eight people and see if we can keep it moving this time.
One, two, three.
Finally, they get the momentum they need, but not the control. Disaster strikes.
Oh, we lost part of the concrete. Okay, so we got going a little bit too fast on our rollers, and we didn't have enough, we weren't fast enough to get the rollers back in front. And by doing that, the rollers came out the back, and the block fell down, and we actually broke our block. Now, if you're in Egypt, this is the sandstone block that's taken months and months to carve. So this block becomes useless, and we have to start all over again. And the problem is, this block's no longer on the rollers, so how do you get it off the ramp, and how do you start over again? The Egyptians must have used extremely tight tolerances because the process just doesn't work unless you're basically perfect with everything that you're doing. And it just gives me that much more respect for Egyptian engineers.
But the pyramid still got built. Since Steve's rejected the main established theories as to how it was done, it's time to look elsewhere. One ancient writer says, mysteriously, that machines were used to raise the stones. Steve thinks he may have found the answer.
So I think that ramps were definitely used in the lower third of the pyramid, the one-third of its height. The ramps that were there would have come perpendicular from the face of the pyramid, all in the lower levels. There were at least four ramps.
It would require a quarter of the materials needed to build a single ramp all the way to the top. And there'd be another big advantage. We know that the angle of the ramp's incline has to be preserved even as it gets taller. But this way, three of the ramps can remain in use while one is being worked on.
You could be raising one of the ramps while you went up the other, so it gave continuous access to the working platform, such that you could keep the men employed, you could keep the stone arriving, and you could be building up ramps that you needed for the next level as you go.
So the stones are delivered, but what next? Steve's theory is dependent on a discovery made by construction expert Dennis Stocks. He had noticed that between some of the pyramid blocks there appeared to be some kind of dried paste. It clearly wasn't for bonding the blocks together. Weight alone did that. He realized that it was there to make the blocks slide.
Oh, that's so easy.
Yes,
that's so easy.
Yes. Well, there you are, you see, Melinda. The gypsum mortar does do the job. Probably about five times less force needed,
yes,
than it was dry.
With this information, Steve's realized that the blocks have been worked so smoothly that once they're at the correct height, they can be slid with comparatively little effort. So all that's needed is the simplest of lifting devices.
So I've got this building where in the bottom levels, I've got mud brick ramps and I can raise the stones up and I can lift them about 150 feet. But as the pyramid gets smaller at the top, I need a different technique to actually lift the stones up.
Steve believes that for the Egyptian engineers, there was an obvious answer. One that sprang, like so much of ancient Egyptian life, from the Nile.
There are techniques already employed in Egypt at this time for lifting loads. There was an instrument called a shadouf, and what it involved was two pieces of wood, top one balanced on a lower one, and they used it like a pivot to lift water out of the Nile.
Shadoufs are the very simplest form of crane. They're still in use today, but the ancient Egyptians definitely had them. And if they can lift water, why couldn't the Egyptians use them to lift stone?
get some wood. It's fairly scarce, but I only need to build a few of these primitive cranes, create a vertical pole with a horizontal section. I can lift a 2-ton stone with 0.5 ton of men on the other end of that piece of wood. That's 8 to 10 men can lift that stone very easily. The way I do it is I bring in the stone, connect some ropes around it, and I just lift it vertically and I hold it up in place. I bring the next stone in below that stone and I can lower it back down at the upper level and I can slide it off sideways. So I have a team that all day long, all they do is lift stones. And I have two other teams, one bringing the stones in, another one taking the stones away. And that's how I think they did it.
So the riddle of the pyramid's construction could be solved with this most primitive machine. Over 20 years, almost 30 centuries ago, the Egyptian genius for organization and precision produced a unique building.
It's very difficult for me to imagine how you could surpass the Great Pyramid. I mean, you could increase the scale, but all of that learning about how to cut the stone and how to build it have come together in something that is just a perfect building.
The Great Pyramid will always be the most visible symbol of Egyptian might and ingenuity. But it's far from the end of the story. Some of Egypt's greatest wonders are engineered so that they might never be seen. This is the Valley of the Kings. Each doorway cut into the rock here is the entrance to an underground world. A place where, for more than 400 years, the pharaoh's tombs were made.
1,000 years after the Great Pyramid Age, there is a change in the way that the king is buried. Previously, the structures for the royal burial were incredibly visible. But when we get into the New Kingdom, they are hidden. They're closed. It's a way to sort of protect the body of the king just that much more.
Imagine putting on X-ray specs and looking underground to see the full extent and complexity of all of the different tunnels and tombs and chambers that make up the Valley of the Kings. And knowing how difficult and dangerous it is to dig them, I think very quickly you start to appreciate the achievement of the Valley of the Kings as being on a par with the building of the Great Pyramids.
63 tombs have been discovered here so far, and some archaeologists believe that there are more out there waiting. Although only the tomb of Tutankhamun was found with its treasures intact, they all once held everything that a king might need in the afterlife. The designs vary in scale from simple pits to complete subterranean palaces. But at the core of each tomb is a burial chamber.
Wow, so this is an absolutely huge room. And of course, we have to realize we're probably about 100 feet below ground level. We're under this huge weight of rock, but it doesn't appear to be in any danger of collapse. It's in really good condition. They've realized where the rock is actually strong and is capable of achieving this. And they've utilized it to form this really large chamber.
This chamber was never finished. The carvers and the decorators were still working when the king died. That's why Steve can see bare rock. But what he really wants to see is the process from the beginning. How were these tunnels cut in the first place? Melinda guides Steve into the tomb of one of Egypt's greatest queens, Hatshepsut. It was one of the first to be dug here over 3,500 years ago. It isn't open to tourists. It's simply too steep and too dangerous. And there's no elaborate decoration here, but for Steve, that's perfect.
Okay, here's an interesting place.
The story of the men who dug this tunnel is cut into its walls.
Do you know what I love about looking at this wall is you can actually see the ancient chisel marks, where they would have just used, you know, a copper or a bronze chisel and a wooden mallet and just hacked away, you know, along the face.
Oh, okay. This is interesting. What we can see here is that's a natural point which to insert a wedge and then to actually drive off that section of rock, it will come away really easily. So they could make really good progress in the tunnel.
This is the reality of ancient Egyptian tunneling. It comes down to a man hacking away with the most primitive tools.
Tunneling is very different today from tunneling in those days. We have huge tunnel boring machines. We protect the people that work in the spaces. We have all sorts of warning systems. We ventilate them. So the techniques are a world apart from the techniques of those days. Okay, so I wonder what's happened. What's happened here? You can see this massive crack that I can put my fingers into in the rock above us here. So at this point, they realized they'd hit a fracture zone. And as they progressed, it started to feel like this slab was just going to collapse on their heads. So they made a decision to reduce the size of the tunnel. You can see the openings got much smaller. And this is basically an attempt to introduce these things as sort of pillars to prop up the roof, just to stop the danger of these slabs collapsing down on the tunnels as they were going. And I'm envisaging that the wear local collapses and all sorts of things, you know, pieces of rock would fall down and kill a man working at the tunnel face. Okay, it's really low here. Looks like we've come to the end. We're in the chamber. Wow.
Amazing.
No.
That's the burial chamber down there of Hatshepsut.
The location of this geologically, I think, is they've chosen this as the end because of the shale. This is a really hard rock. And it's so raw, and you can see everything exactly how it happened. Fantastic. I mean, it's just a wonderful piece of engineering.
It travels 210 meters down. The tunnel twists and turns, suddenly changing direction to follow the seam of the rock. It may seem chaotic, but this, like so much the Egyptians built, is part of a bigger plan. The tomb is carefully placed in relation to the temple that Hatshepsut made for herself on the other side of the valley ridge. And going wider, the connections continue.
If you take a line on the main axis of her burial chamber, it first aligns almost perfectly with Hatshepsut's temple, which then aligns with the great thoroughfare at Karnak. You see, when it came to building tombs, monuments, and temples, the Egyptians left nothing to chance.
And if the Valley of the Kings was a hidden place, made to honor Egypt's royal dead, Karnak was made to strike awe into the living.
Steve, here we are. This is the Temple of Amun-Ra at Karnak. You've got 1,500 years of history here, of construction, of destruction, and also of reconstruction. And inside, you have got pillars, you have columns, you have shrines, you've got courts, and it's huge. It's essentially a mile long, and it is 2/3 of a mile wide.
You can't think of Karnak as a single building. It was built over 1,300 years, with different builders and pharaohs adding layer upon layer to create the complex that we see today.
The greatest building at Karnak is a pillared or hypostyle hall. The engineer's job here was to create a space worthy to be the home of the sun god and capable of inspiring awe in all who entered. There are 134 pillars here, most as tall as a seven-story building. Each one weighs an estimated 280 tons.
When you come in this building, the whole thing is disorientating. The columns are huge. They're 8 to 10 feet diameter, and they go 40 feet high. So that's a very strange ratio. They're also extremely close together, and the distance between them is only 10 feet, 12 feet. They're incredibly close. So what you get, the idea of the building is it's just a forest of columns.
It's immediately clear that the columns were put together on site. Each one is a stack of limestone pieces, semicircles that have been worked to a precise shape. And though there are dozens of them in each column, each piece still weighs around 5 tons. So the question is, how were they lifted? But what holds them together? Why don't they separate, topple? While Steve surveys the site, Melinda goes to find out. By looking at other ruined Egyptian buildings and studying the exposed stone, Dennis Stocks has worked out what's going on inside the giant columns.
We have to make a butterfly cramp, one of these, that will fit into these two slots when it's joined together. Now, you can see that when this is in position, because of its shape, you won't be able to pull them apart again. And when the next segment is on top of this, as the column rises up, then they're never going to move, because these will always be in position. Sometimes they're wood, sometimes they're stone, sometimes they're made of metal.
The butterfly cramp is simple to make. And once the stones of the drum balance each other out, with all the weight on top, they're not going anywhere.
On one hand, the hypostyle hall is a very simple building. We totally know how the engineering works, how it stands up. But what we don't know is how they built it, how they put it together. And finding that out is a real challenge.
Sometimes it's very hard to look at something in its finished state and figure out how it was actually built. And the reason for that is that in all structures, modern structures as well, we have what is called temporary works. And what we see left behind is the permanent works. So when we're placing concrete today, we use wood. We use wood formwork. We place the concrete on it. Once the concrete is set, we remove the wood formwork. So if you go and look at the concrete afterwards, it's like a mystery. How was that done? That's what we're looking at inside of this huge hall.
The consensus among archaeologists is that these columns were built not by lifting the stones high in the air, but by raising the ground itself. The theory is that every time a layer of stones was added, the spaces were packed with sand to create a new working platform. Dr. Bob Bianchi is a world expert on the temples at Karnak.
You probably would have this entire area filled as a big sand pile that would all have to be excavated out in the end.
So they built these by filling the whole area with something to a level that they could actually work from, a working platform. Yeah. At which point we've just got a forest of buried columns.
Well, that's one suggestion. And then the Sea Grizzly maintains that there was a ramp that was built in order to be able to bring the sections of the column into place. The question is, what were the ramps made out of and how were they constructed?
It seems an attractive solution. Bringing the stone up ramps to a huge, ever-growing sandbox would mean the hall could be built without using any kind of crane or scaffold.
But there's a real problem with that hypothesis, that theory. Because when you get sand in a big enough volume, it starts to act a bit like a liquid. It starts to flow. So yes, you've solved the problem of lifting up the bits of column and roof, but in doing so, you've actually created a whole different set of problems.
So what I'm drawing here is what I've called the box. The box is actually the hypostyle hall itself. So what we see here, these are the walls that we see here, that are these 40 to 70 feet high walls that surround the building. This sort of huge masonry box would have been what is filled with sand to allow the roof to go on. The first question is, this is a huge compacted sand pressure. I mean, there's no way the walls are going to be able to withstand this pressure. And so the only way that they could have carried that load is if the sand was also outside the building. So it's like a huge sand mountain to equalize the pressure across the walls.
In fact, the volume of sand needed to support these massive walls would be enough to bury the temple and most of the buildings around it.
To have used sand to infill this building as the temporary works material is just impossible. And there has to be another solution other than this one.
So how was it done? It's Melinda's expertise that provides the answer. She brings Steve back across the Nile to the graveyard known as the Valley of the Nobles. This tomb was cut for a man who lived around the time of the hall's construction. The scene painted on its walls looks very familiar.
I mean, it looks like it could be the building of the columns at the Hypostyle Hall. It could be that, because the columns are built in sections.
The other thing is that between the columns here, it's not sand. Instead, what we have is we have mud bricks.
In ancient Egypt, mud brick is the poor man's material. But it's cheap, and it's easy to produce on site. It gives both the ancient engineers and our team their answer.
So that as the columns were placed, so too did this, you know, mud brick platform go up as well.
So I just didn't see how they could possibly have filled the hypostyle hall with sand. Whereas with this, with the mud brick, they could use exactly the same principles, roll the stones up, and then work on top of the mud brick without putting huge horizontal forces on the walls. I'm pretty sure that's how they built it. So this is a 2,500-year-old builder's instruction manual for bricklayers.
It is, exactly. That's exactly what it is.
Fantastic.
So they did build it by burying it. It's an extraordinary way to put up a building. As the mud bricks came away, the construction team was replaced by a new sort of worker. The men who decorated the stone, carving, painting. Slowly and uniquely, the hypostyle hall was revealed from the top down.
When you look at ancient monuments today, it's quite easy to think that they were always stone-coloured in Greece, in Rome, and here in Egypt, but it's just not true. The hypostyle hall would have been highly decorated from floor to ceiling and on the walls in bright, bold colours. It would have had a roof. There would have been chanting. There would have been incense burning. There would have been shafts of sunlight piercing through that thick atmosphere. It would have been awe-inspiring, and quite deliberately so. So while what we see today is breathtaking, it is a shadow of its former self.
Over the years, most of the complex at Karnak has decayed. The roof of the hall has gone, the sandstone blocks worn away. But one structure remains intact, virtually as it was on the day it was first put up. Chris Carroll's team have taken on the most complex challenge. They're going to try and replicate what is literally the high point of Egyptian engineering. Concrete is standing in for red granite, as they try and build one of these. It's an obelisk.
The obelisk is incredible, but primarily because it's the tallest thing on the site at Karnak, so it stands above everything else. And the question is, when you look at it as a single piece of stone, I mean, how on earth did they make it and raise that obelisk?
Most Egyptian obelisks have been broken up or carted off, but this one, built again by Queen Hatshepsut, has never been touched. That may be because it's a single piece of stone, 30 meters tall.
Wow.
What an impressive. Incredible. Up close and personal. This is one of the few monuments in Egypt which is actually giving us a little bit of the history how it was quarried and how it was moved.
So how long did it take to quarry? Is there anything on here that tells us about that?
Yes, we're told on the inscription on the north side that it was 7 months in the quarry to get two of them out, not one.
7 months?
7 months to get this and its mate, which was across the main axis.
Is there anything on here that tells us about how it might have been erected and lifted?
No, that's the big mystery. They're silent about that. They tell us about where it came from and why it's here, but not how it got here.
Perhaps the best way to work out how it was done is to do it. At the University of Louisiana, Dr. Chris Carroll and his team are going to give it a go.
All right, so we've built an obelisk. Ours is concrete, not granite, and not nearly to the scale as the Egyptians, but we are going to try to raise our obelisk the way we think that they did it.
Once we get under it a little bit.
The Lafayette obelisk is 5 meters tall, and it weighs 1,400 kilos. This is a baby compared to what the engineers at Karnak put up.
All right.
But right away, it's obvious that it's going to be tricky to maneuver. The ancient Egyptians didn't have a forklift to get their obelisk to site.
Hang on a minute. This is going to break a bar a little bit.
Any stone this shape is hard to lift, but it's also brittle. It's relatively easy to break.
All right, back up, hands up close. Tilt forward. Not quite that much. All right there. All right, now just be heads up where you're at.
Once an obelisk is standing, it can stand for centuries. But getting it vertical, because of its shape, that is a risky business.
The danger is that as it's raised, it starts to bend. And when it bends, it can crack. And that crack would then spread from the bottom of the obelisk right the way through and snap in half.
The stresses involved mean that the piece of stone has to be flawless, or it will simply shear apart. In a granite quarry down in Aswan, there's even an obelisk half cut out of the rock, and then abandoned when the engineers discovered a fault running through it. They simply had to start again.
Okay, that's good. Just pick up on it, real slow. Now, come forward just a little bit. Okay, good job, so no cracks. We would like not to crack our obelisk. If this is on a larger scale and you're in Egypt, you lose years and years and years of carvings. And you have to basically start over. I mean, some people would use their whole lifetimes carving one obelisk. And to see it crack, I mean, you just lose everything.
The danger will be greatest as the obelisk is going up. That means finding a way of lifting one end while supporting the body of the stone and guiding the base precisely into position. Both the bottom of the obelisk and the plinth on which it sits have to be perfectly smooth and perfectly flat.
The key component is actually the platform itself. It has to be perfectly level, and we have to have a way for the obelisk to catch on it. So if we check to see if it's level. looks pretty good in both directions. Now, in addition to that, we also have a little ledge at the front of the pedestal that we're going to use for the obelisk to catch on. And from that point, we'll actually tilt up the obelisk.
The solution Chris and Steve have hit on will involve some very precise movements, and again, the use of the one thing the Egyptians certainly had. Sand. They're building a sandbox, 2.5 meters deep.
Hey Greg, bring some more sand.
If their plan works, the obelisk will slide into place under its own weight. Among many archaeologists, received wisdom is that the obelisk was hauled vertical by an army of laborers. If this is what happened, it involved a superhuman piece of organization.
I find it amazing, the idea that it was men pulling on ropes that pulled it vertical.
Yeah, I think you have to worry if the factor here is manpower leverage. You could use one man for maybe for about a half a ton.
Yeah.
And so you just have to extrapolate from that, and you've got thousands of bodies, I guess, yanking on one end of several ropes to be able to get it up. Yeah.
The problem is that this is a 300-ton rock as tall as a 10-story building. Maybe manpower could provide the brute force to move it, but it would be impossibly clumsy.
Let's say it was brought in horizontally, and you got a group of men and you said, I want to lift this obelisk off the floor. It would involve thousands of people, all to be coordinated. You know, 1, 2, 3 pull wouldn't do it.
Steve believes that the best way the Egyptians could have put the obelisk in place was to let gravity do the work. They begin by laying the foundation on which it would stand, then build a chamber around it, a kind of well filled with sand. It's approached on one side by a ramp.
If you were to take a bird's eye view of the site on lifting day, on one side there would be a huge ramp that runs a long way that they can actually drag this huge weight up the ramp, and then much steeper on the other.
For the purpose of this experiment, Hatshepsut's army of loincloth-clad workers is replaced by Craig and his truck.
Okay, that's good. That's perfect. Right.
The obelisk has been placed very carefully into position.
And the idea is that you would bring the obelisk up and let it project out, and this is where the enterprise gets really risky, and then use its weight to allow it to tip against the face without breaking.
The sand is there to control this movement. By slowly releasing it, digging it out, the team can dictate exactly how and how quickly the obelisk falls. They open 2 gates in the side of the box. The sand begins to flow, and the boys begin to dig. Over 18 tons of sand for a 2-ton obelisk. Of course, Hatshepsut's obelisk was 200 times heavier. Slowly a void grows beneath the stone. Its base is now balanced only on a thin ridge of sand, and it's just a matter of time.
There it goes, there it goes!
As the obelisk continues to subside, the challenge for the team lies in safely getting the sand out from underneath.
There we go! Hey, pull that way, just a hair! Okay. Right now, we're holding the entire weight of the obelisk on a rope that's supported by a truck. And you have to think that ours is only about 3,000 pounds. If you scale it up to an Egyptian obelisk, think about how many people that would actually take to hold up. I think that is possible with enough people, but it takes a lot of coordination as well.
I see daylight under the hallway, so it's good.
I mean, how much is left?
Alright, there's not too much sand left, but it keeps falling on top of the pedestal. So if we can get enough of it out to keep that from happening, we'll be ready to set it now.
Alright, let's brush it off.
Let's do this. Let's set it down. It's pretty clear. There's nothing to snag on, so let's go ahead and do this. You ready, Craig? All right, everybody, keep the ropes taut. Just a little bit, buddy. A little bit more. Whoa. All right, we need to pull that way. Let off a little bit on this side. Pull a little bit. Hold right there. All right, we're good. All right, a little bit more. Hold. All right, hold right there. We're on it. All right, good job. Ready? Good job.
You go through such an incredibly long process excavating the stone, bringing it to site, raising it in place, and it's only in that final moment that it's either right or wrong. If you raise the obelisk and it slides out of position, or it twists, or it's not vertical, there's really not a lot you can do.
You're not going to pull as tight as they do, but you're going to kind of let it. Okay, you're going to kind of let it go. All right, but you got to keep it from going all the way. Go ahead and pull just a little bit.
There's no taking it back down and trying again. You get one shot at this, and you've got to get it right.
I think we're good. Set.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Don't touch it. Hey, come look at it.
And that's how you raise an obelisk using just rope and sand and human ingenuity. All but a tiny fraction of what the Egyptians built is gone. Torn down, buried, or blown away.
All buildings are designed for a life. And if they're left to their own devices over extended periods of time, they'll all end up as dust on the floor at some point in the future. Nature will return it back to the material that it started from. The only question is when.
This is Alexandria, Egypt's biggest city in the last years of the pharaohs. In its murky, silted harbor, ongoing excavations keep revealing treasures. Glimpses of the fabulous world once inhabited by kings and queens like Cleopatra. They've also thrown up pieces of a massive structure, one of the last buildings produced by the mighty Egyptian Empire. It became one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. The Lighthouse of Alexandria. The Pharos.
Of all the buildings we're looking at, the Pharos is unique because it no longer exists. It's passed into myth. We have lots of vivid descriptions of it, and we have these wonderful images. But in order to bust through these myths and find out what it was really like, we need to know three things: where it was built, how it was built, and why it fell down.
Over the centuries, the shoreline has shifted and the shape of the harbour has changed dramatically. That made the where, the location of the building, a subject for argument among scholars. But then in the sea, just beyond this fortress, the dive teams pulled up stones so large that they could have only come from one building.
So this is a piece of the pharos?
Yes, pretty certainly. This is what we reckon is one of the door jams.
This is a huge piece of stone. Any idea what it weighs?
About 70 tons.
And this was lifted upright in the construction?
This should have stood upright.
Incredible.
The stones were part of a doorway that stood 12 meters high by more than 5 meters wide. But what of the rest of the structure?
It's a very difficult challenge, this one, because the only pieces we can see are on the seabed or on the harbour side, and so we have to piece it together like a huge jigsaw puzzle.
Steve travels along the coast to Abu Sir. There's a structure here whose building dates to around the same time as the pharos. It's the tomb of an Egyptian dignitary, and although it's not very tall, in every other respect, it matches exactly to ancient eyewitness descriptions of the pharos.
It is accepted to be a quarter-size replica of the pharos. I mean, it's repeating the shapes, the stages of the pharos. We've got a square base, octagonal middle section, and cylindrical top. So it gives us an idea of what the pharos looked like, yet it's only a quarter of the size.
So we have the pieces of the puzzle, and we know from the door jam the kind of proportion of the building. When you apply that to the little pharos, you get a height of the building, and it's about 300 feet. Now, you have to remember this was built more than 2,200 years ago. There is nothing approaching that in a tower anywhere on the planet.
Unlike the other monuments of Egypt, this building had a practical purpose. It stood, a functioning lighthouse on the edge of the ocean, for more than 1,000 years.
So it was a living structure that required continuous maintenance, care, and attention.
And that may explain why it fell. It outlasted the pharaohs. Part of it still stood here as late as the 14th century. But without the might of an empire to fuel its fires and repair the damage done by the battering waves, it had to come down.
Have you ever seen a building demolished? You just get some sort of sense of just how much weight there is up in the air. And when it comes down, the force is huge, the whole ground shakes, you know, it's just massive. Let me paint a picture of the collapse of the pharos. So we're there looking at this huge structure, standing 30 stories in the air, but it's fallen into disrepair. So what has happened is that nobody is applying any more cement mortar to cover the joints. The joints have opened up, they've worn away due to sand being driven against it, and the wind and the rain and the saline air, the salt in the air. And the embedded metal has started to corrode.
The iron cramps which have held the stones in place become the building's weak point.
When metal rusts, it gets much bigger, and there's a massive power in that, and so the stones will split. So basically, the pharos started to rot from the inside. It will have started to fall to pieces, but eventually it just gets more and more unstable. It will have eroded at the bottom to such an extent that nature eventually applies a force greater than the structure can resist, and then it just collapses. The whole thing, 30 stories, straight into the ocean. And that's all we can see today. We can go and find those pieces. They've scattered a long way offshore, but that's all that's left of the pharos.
In any other culture, a building like the pharos might be the crowning achievement. But Egypt is different. The engineers of ancient Egypt didn't build like anyone else then or now. It's partly about the scale of the work, partly about the fact that they didn't have the technology that we take for granted. It's also about what these men, thousands of years ago, were trying to achieve.
Quite often the brief for tall buildings around the world is that they will have a life of 60 years. I know that doesn't seem very long. Maybe they'll last 100 years, but it's quite a defined period of time. Compare that to the pyramids, where the brief was for the buildings to last forever. And what we're looking at are structures that have lasted 5,000 years already.
Our teams have examined and attempted the kind of work that the Egyptians produced. They've seen the ingenuity, the ambition, and the effort involved.
It seems like the Egyptians are doing something that we just can't replicate. I mean, we're using modern tools, we're using bubble levels, things like that, and we just can't get our tolerances that tight. I think it's possible, but is it probable for us to do it? No, I don't think so. It just gives me that much more respect for Egyptian engineers.
These men devoted their lives to glorifying their kings, to honoring them for eternity. In doing so, creating buildings that will stand long after we've gone. They won their own immortality.